Okay, so last time we looked at how we could use the principle of logical effort to quickly decide between multiple different implementations for a simple logic function, right? This was what we wanted to implement, y is equal to a, b, c, d, right? And what we said was there were multiple ways of implementing this logic. We considered two examples, one of which was a straight 4-input NAND gate followed by an inverter. The second was a chain of 2-input NAND gates followed by inverters, right? There are other possibilities, for example, a 4-input NOR gate followed by, or rather, inverters followed by a NOR gate, right? You could use, for example, a 3-input NAND gate followed by a 2-input NAND gate, right? Lots of other combinations are possible in order to do something of this sort, right? The important point about the logical effort approach is that it allowed us to quickly evaluate roughly what should be the sizes of gates that I should use for each of these combinations in order to get the minimum delay, and what would be the best possible delay that I can get. Okay. Now, in practice, one of the things that you will find is you do not get to choose gate sizes with complete freedom. Okay. You cannot just choose a gate, for example, and say that I want it to be 3.7 times the reference inverter. Okay. In fact, you may not even be able to choose 5 times, even though that's an integer multiple. Typically, what you will find is in the library, there will be something called an X1 inverter, an X2 inverter, an X4, X8, and so on. Okay. What are the options available to you given these kind of inverters? Right. You choose the one that is closest in size to what you want. Okay. But that automatically means that your edge calculations and so on are different from what you would optimally like to see. Okay. But you can at least get something which is sort of trying and minimizing or reducing the delay. Maybe not minimizing it, but definitely reducing it compared to a naive implementation. Okay. The important point about the logical effort approach is it allows you to do these calculations very quickly by hand without doing detailed simulations. Okay. So now I'm going to just talk about two further issues as far as logical effort is concerned, but the rest of it we'll take up by means of assignments or tutorial questions so that you understand the concept a bit better. Okay. These two concepts, one of them is so-called branching. Right? How does a branching path affect your computations in terms of logical effort? Okay, what do I mean by a branching path? Essentially, I'm talking about something like this. Let's say I have one gate over here. It's feeding into a NAND gate. This is feeding into a NOR gate, which is again feeding into an inverter, right? I don't care what the functionality is. I'm just drawing something which is a possible situation that you might encounter in practice. Okay? Normally, how would you go about calculating the delay through this chain? I would estimate what is the input capacitance over here. This, I would call it as, let's say, C1, okay? The first stage capacitance. Okay, so what is C1? This is actually the input capacitance seen here, right? The size of that inverter. Okay, similarly, at this net over here, I would have some capacitance C2. Okay, at this net, I would have some capacitance C3. Over here, I would have C4, and eventually, I would have some CL. Okay. So, how do we do computations with this? Essentially, what we would define is the H1, the first stage, would be equal to C2 by C1. G1 in this case would be equal to 1, okay? Which implies that the delay through the first stage would be 1 into C2 by C1 plus 1, right? Second stage, H2, would be C3 by C2. Its logical effort, because it's a 2-input NAND gate, is equal to 4 by 3. So the delay is equal to 4 by 3 times C3 by C2 plus 2, which is the parasitic delay of the 2-input NAND gate. And so on. Okay? So far, so good. This is what we have looked at in the previous classes. This is how we basically understand how the logical effort principle is to be applied. In this way, I would calculate D1, D2, D3, D4. add up the total delay through the circuit and get the complete path delay. Okay. Now, what if my circuit looks slightly different? In other words, at this point over here, I had some other connection. Okay. I don't even care what kind of gate it is. It might be one gate, it might be multiple gates, right? It might even be something leading off into something else like this. Okay. The important point over here is the fact that there are wires leading to other gates, right, increases the total capacitance at this point, or rather at this point. Okay. So what happens when the capacitance at this point, which I will mark as X, increases? What will be the effect of the increasing that capacitance? D1, the delay through the inverter will increase. Okay? Will it affect the delay through the NAND gate? Huh? How will it affect the delay through the NAND gate? Why should it decrease? C2, I'm saying that the effective capacitance at X has increased. Okay? What determines the delay through the NAND gate? Is it the capacitance at X or is it the size of the NAND gate? It is only the size of the NAND gate. The fact that there are other gates connected at X, therefore increasing the total capacitance at X, is irrelevant. Okay? So the fact that there are additional capacitances connected at X is not helping me deliver more current out of the NAND gate. Okay, the NAND gate remains the same size. How much current can it deliver? Whatever it could deliver before. Before I connected these extra capacitances. For the inverter, there is a problem. It is seeing extra capacitance on its output, on its load. Whatever current it delivers has to go into that excess capacitance. So the inverter will slow down. The NAND gate, on the other hand, does not see anything helpful. It is just some capacitance on its input side. It is not increasing the current that it can deliver. Okay? So this is an important point. What has happened over here is, now I need to be very clear how I define H. Okay? So what I am going to do is write down the new values of H in red so that, you know, the distinction is made clear. Right? Supposing this total capacitance, right, is some, I'll call it Cx. Okay? In that case, as far as the inverter is concerned, H1, right, the electrical effort that it sees, the fan out that it sees, is going to be given by how much? C2 plus Cx divided by C1. Okay? And its logical effort remains the same. So D1 now becomes C2 plus Cx divided by C1 plus 1. But what about H2? It is still C3 by C2. It is not C3 by C2 plus Cx. Okay? This is important. Keep this in mind. What I am doing when I compute logical effort is not just measure the capacitance at this point and divide it to find out that ratio. I measure it for a given gate, the output capacitance it has to drive divided by its own capacitance, not the capacitance at the input terminal. That might consist of other connections also. Its own capacitance, the NAND gate, how much capacitance does the NAND gate have? That is what determines how much current it can deliver. Because that is what determines the size of the transistors. Okay? So H2 in other words remains C3 by C2. It is not C3 by C2 plus Cx. Okay? So in such a situation, the fact that there is this branch over here, right? The connection is leading off somewhere to some other gates, is effectively causing a slowdown in my circuit, right? Why? Because the first stage, the inverter, has to drive a larger load. But the second stage is not being helped. On the other hand, if the change that I had made was, I take the NAND gate itself and make it bigger, right? So instead of connecting a CX on the side, if I had taken C2 itself and made it larger, then that will actually help the NAND gate, right? The NAND gate will be able to deliver a larger current. Right now that does not happen, okay? What is the effect of this? H1 has increased, therefore D1, the delay through the first stage, has increased. H2 remained the same, so D2 also remains the same, which means that the total delay through the path has increased, okay? Why did it increase? Because I had some branching path which had nothing to do with my core functionality, right? The path that I am interested in is only passing through inverter, NAND gate, NOR gate and another inverter before hitting the load, okay? This path on the side may or may not be relevant as far as I am concerned. I mean, of course it's relevant, otherwise it would not be there in my circuit, right? But in order to find out which is the longest path or the delay, the critical path as we will come to later, I might not really be interested in that side path. Okay, so that is the thing that you need to keep in mind over here. So how do we take this branching into account, right? In general, if you look at the textbook, right, they sort of try and reduce everything to a formula where they talk about the total logical effort, capital G, multiply the logical efforts of all the stages, capital H, the total end-to-end electrical effort, and then one term B, capital B, which captures all the branches, the effects of the branches, okay? I'm not going to take that approach over here. I don't want to try and reduce it to a formula that you blindly apply. I'm just leaving it at the concept. You can apply the formula provided you go through it and understand it, okay? So I would strongly suggest you look at that part of the text, okay? I think some of the slides are also available online. We'll try and make those available in case any of you want it as a reference, right? But keep this in mind, don't try and just apply a formula. Understand the concept, what is happening over here. Then it will be clear where the delays will increase, where the delays will not change, okay? So as far as we are concerned, the main thing that we sort of need to keep in mind is the branching or the effective delay that we need to compute at each stage is just given by the H multiplied by the G and the P, right? This is property of the gate. This is the total load at the gate by size of the gate itself. Not the size of the input capacitance or the capacitance at that terminal, right? See, at this point X, the capacitance, if I was to somehow try and measure the total capacitance at X, I'll find C2 plus CX, okay? That's not what I'm interested in order to find out the delay through the NAND gate. The CX is not helping me. Only the C2 is helping me, because a larger value of C2 means it can deliver a larger current and therefore the delay through the NAND gate will decrease. Okay. And of course this is again a property of the gate, right? Why is P a constant? Essentially what we are saying over there is, if I make the NAND gate larger, good, its ability to drive current into the load is larger, but the parasitics are also larger. So the P essentially becomes a constant independent of the size of the gate, okay? Another way of sort of looking at this branching, right, we can sort of think of it as, I have a gate which is driving some other multiple gates, okay? There is some capacitance associated with each of those gates, right? I'm going to call this on path and these other things this is off path, Okay. What do I mean by off path? It means that the path that I'm interested in passes through these two gates where the red line is going. Okay. The blue lines, on the other hand, are also influencing the delay through that path because they influence the delay of the first gate in this chain. But they do not influence the delay of the second gate. Okay. So you can sort of try and capture this in one term which says I will take C on path plus C off path divided by C on path. Right? This is one small term, one B term, which I can sort of add into that GH plus P if I want to. Right? I can make it G into B into H if I want, where H is now defined as total capacitance at the output divided by total capacitance at the input. Right? But this can just be confusing, so don't get into that. Consider each gate by itself. Its electrical effort is what is the load that it sees divided by its size, its input terminal capacitance, irrespective of what else is connected to that input terminal. Okay? The important part about this is, if I was to consider a path through a circuit and I'm trying to find the delay through it, right? Effectively, what this is telling me is the path through one, you know, the delay through one path in a circuit, right? Normally, first cut, when we talk about propagation delay, we sort of try and say every gate has a propagation delay. In order to find the total delay through a path, I just add up the propagation delays through each element in that path. Now what it's saying is the propagation delay through a gate might depend on things which are branching off from that path, which have nothing to do with the core functionality of the path itself. Okay? So the side gates, in other words, can also influence the delay on a given path. Okay? This is something important to keep in mind. One of the main places where it affects you is at some point while trying to do optimizations on circuits, very likely what you will want to do is try and take out a gate and replace it with another gate with the same functionality but a different kind of behavior, right? Maybe a different drive strength, maybe a different size, different threshold voltage, right? Some characteristic of it might be different. The important thing is that one change that you made over here affects not only this gate, it also affects anything else that it is connected to, even though it is not directly on the path through that gate. Okay. So this branching effect also has to be taken into account. As far as we are concerned, the important thing is just this. Keep this in mind. The electrical effort at any point for the NAND gate here, for example, is C3 by C2, not C2 plus CX. But for the inverter, the first inverter, it is C2 plus CX divided by C1. Right? That's all that you really need to understand to make sure that you take branching properly into account. Okay? Alright, the next thing that we want to look at as far as logical effort, or rather, this is not logical effort, this is more to do with the parasitic delay. Right? Let's take a closer look at the NAND gate, right? And consider the parasitic delay through the NAND gate. Okay? What we are saying is, I have a situation like this. This has some capacitance over here. Input size is 4C. Let's just consider a reference NAND gate. Right? It is connected to some CL. Okay? The delay through this, if I look at it, is essentially given by this 3RC into 4 by 3 CL by 4C plus C parasitic by 3C. Right? This is how we sort of arrived at the original logical effort computation. Okay. And from this, what we said was C parasitic is equal to 6 times C, implies that the parasitic delay is equal to 2. This is the computation that we came to. Okay? How did we come up with this number that C parasitic is equal to 6 times C? What we said was, the schematic looks something like this. Thank you. over here I have a capacitance of 2C from this PMOS, another capacitance of 2C from this PMOS, and a capacitance of 2C from this NMOS. Right? Now, in addition to all of this, there is also an extra effect from this capacitance which is in the middle node between the two NMOS transistors. There will be some capacitance, right? Because it is after all a diffusion region, right? An N plus diffusion region which is combined as far as the two NMOS transistors are concerned, but nevertheless occupies some area, has a depletion region associated with it, and therefore will have a capacitance. Okay? Again, a rough estimate of how much is that capacitance, you can estimate what the area of that diffusion region is going to be. A good approximation is that this will also be 2C. Okay, but it depends on the layout. Okay, right now I will assume that it is 2C. Okay, assuming that I have done the layout reasonably well, I can probably get the capacitance to be 2C. One thing I can be sure is it is going to be proportional to C, because after all it is going to be proportional to the widths of the transistors and so on. Okay, so assuming that it is 2C, the question that I now need to answer is, what is the true value of the parasitic load that I see over here? Okay, to answer that, let's consider the rising and falling transitions separately. Okay, for the rising transition, what I will have is effectively some R, right, equivalent. I'm just replacing the PMOS with an equivalent capacitance, some CL, and the total parasitic capacitance over here, right? If I look at this, okay, once again, assume that A is off in this case, right? A is equal to 0. Okay, consider the case where A is equal to 0. Effectively, what it's saying is that middle node between A and B is completely separated from Y. So any change at Y is not going to even see the node X. Right? I'll just mark this as X. Okay? Which means that the total capacitance that I see over here is in fact equal to 6C. Right? And the parasitic load is equal to 6C by 3C is equal to 2. Or rather, this is C parasitic and we have 6C by 3C equal to 2. Sorry, that's P, thanks. Now let's look at the falling transition. Okay, what happens over there? Both the NMOS are on. What is the resistance through each of the NMOS? We have two NMOS, we have made them of size 2 so that each one has a resistance of R by 2 so that the total resistance is R. Okay. So let's draw this equivalent circuit. What do we have here? We have something which looks like a tree. Okay. Effectively, what I have is this circuit looks something like this. There is a supply. If you look at it, that supply is actually equal to 0 volts, which is connected to R by 2, 2C, R by 2, and 6C. I will leave out the CL for now. Okay, doesn't matter, you can always add the CL, it just adds to that. Okay, the initial voltage here is VDD, it is high, it is going to discharge. Okay, what would be the time constant for it to discharge through this supply of 0 volts? How do they compute it? We have to apply the Elmore delay formula that we looked at earlier, right? Remember, for Elmore delay, what I said was, I apply a voltage at some point and I'm going to measure the time required for charging at some other point further down the line, right? Provided that that thing looks like a tree. In this case, it looks like a tree. I am not applying a high voltage and waiting for that output point to charge up. I'm waiting for it to discharge, which I can equivalently look at it as exactly the same. It is initially charged to VDD. I'm applying a voltage of 0, right? The discharge or the charge look completely symmetrical from that point of view. So the delay, in other words, is going to be given by, or the time constant is going to be given by R by 2 into 2C plus total resistance R into 6C. Right? Remember the shared resistance part, right? What is the shared resistance from this 0 volt source up to the first capacitance? R by 2. So that R by 2 into that first capacitance 2C plus shared resistance all the way to the final point is R multiplied by 6C. Okay? So this becomes equal to RC plus 6RC, 7 times RC. Okay? Over here, it was effectively 6 times RC because there is only one component, that is on R multiplied by 6C. Okay? So what is the parasitic delay that I have in the second case? It is 7 by 3 instead of 6 by 3. Okay? Now, couple of things to keep in mind, right? This is an approximation on multiple levels. One is the Elmore delay formula is not exact. That itself is an approximation. Second is the two NMOS transistors do not exactly have resistances of R by 2. The resistances themselves are dependent on the voltages that are currently there across them, right? That R by 2 was taken as an average across a wide range, okay? Third, all of these capacitances themselves are voltage dependent, okay? So, do not try and, in other words, say that this is going to be, you know, this is 7 by 3 versus 6 by 3, therefore this is going to be so much more. All that you can say is this is likely to be more than the other delay. How much? The only way to do it is to actually do a detailed simulation and find out. Okay? For this 7 by 3 versus 6 by 3, the difference is so small that in fact it might even just disappear in terms of the actual computations that you come up with. But let's say that for a 4 input NAND gate, right? What will the 4 input NAND gate look like? The following transition over there would look like R by 4, 2C, sorry, not 2C, 4C, R by 4, 4C, R by 4, 4C, R by 4, right? And over here there would be some 4C from the NMOS plus again 4C from the PMOS. Or 8C from the PMOS. Okay? Now the chain starts to look as though those internal capacitances cannot be completely ignored. Okay? The effect of this starts to become more and more pronounced, right? As you go to longer and longer stacks. Okay? So in other words, the whole point of this discussion is, if I want to get a more accurate estimate of the parasitic effort, I can do it in this manner, right? Is it worthwhile? May not be. It depends on what you are actually trying to do with your computations. For the most part, we are more concerned with the logical effect because that directly tells us whether a 2 input NAND gate or a 2 input NOR gate is a better gate to apply in a particular situation, just in terms of how I can compare their delays, right? The parasitic is a secondary effect. If I want a slightly more accurate estimate of the actual delay, I can do a more detailed computation. The main takeaway from this is for longer chains, right, this starts becoming proportional to n. Right, the total delay, the additional delay that I have over here itself starts to increase, so I can no longer just ignore it. Which is why for long chains of this sort, taking this Elmore formula and computing the parasitic delay more accurately may be required. Okay, so anyway, that's just something to keep in mind, right? As far as the rest of the course is concerned, what we will do is pretty much, unless explicitly specified in some case, we will pretty much assume that you ignore all the intermediate node capacitances and the parasitics are just based on the output node itself. Okay. Alright, to sum up, what is the point of logical effort? It allows us to abstract the delay into three components. One of them is a property of the gate, which is the logical effort. It just depends on how the choices of transistor sizes were made for that particular gate. The second one is also a property of the gate. It is the parasitic, right? Effectively, what the parasitic is telling you is the larger you make the transistors in the gate, they can deliver more current, but they also incur a greater penalty. Okay? And the third component is, I have chosen certain sizes for this particular gate. That will influence how easy it is to drive an external load, the H, the electrical effort. Okay? Which means that I can make my choice of transistor sizes primarily based on what electrical effort I need to drive. Okay? And when I combine that with that insight that we used earlier, which was this fan out of 4, right? Fan out of 4, again, it is not an exact computation, it is just an observation that as you sort of vary the sizes, when you are seeing more or less a fan out close to 4, somewhere between 3 and 4, that's when the delay sort of becomes optimized through the entire chain. Right? It is based on the observation of the values that we actually have over there. Right? Which means that I can sort of apply that concept of fan out of 4 and say, okay, the G into H at each stage, try and make it close to 4 to get an overall good value for the delay through the chain. Okay. Why do we use this? At the end of the day, there are tools which can do a complete full-blown simulation. You know SPICE already, right? There is no particular reason to limit yourself to only like 2 or 3 transistors when doing SPICE simulation. SPICE can handle hundreds or thousands of transistors if necessary. So I could like put in my entire circuit and do a full SPICE simulation across it to find out detailed delays. But if I make a small change somewhere and once again need to run the full SPICE simulation in order to calculate it, and then, you know, it gives me no insight into what has happened. Whereas this approach of logical effort, the whole purpose is to give you some insight into how the gates should be chosen to get a good value for the delay through the chain. Okay? Alright. So, that finishes our discussion of logical effort. Right, we will look at some more examples of this as tutorial problems or assignments later. Hopefully it will make things a bit more clear. Now what we want to do is move on to the next topic, which is, so far we have looked only at static CMOS. Okay, what is the idea behind static CMOS? I have a pull-up network, I have a pull-down network. The pull-up network is connected to VDD, the pull-down network is connected to ground. The same inputs are applied to the pull-up and pull-down networks, and I have an output which is taken at the connection between those two networks. Okay. For static CMOS, what do I need to ensure? Pull-up network and pull-down network should be completely complementary. Right? At any given point in time, one and exactly one of these two must be on. At any given point of time means for a given set of input values. Okay? Either the pull-up network or the pull-down network should be on. Both should not come on at the same time. Okay? So what does that guarantee? It means that my output Y for any given value of input is going to be either pulled up to VDD or pulled down to ground. There will never be a static path which exists directly from VDD to ground through this network. Okay, so that is the sort of principle behind static CMOS. It makes my implementation very easy. I take the truth table that I want to implement, look at all the entries that correspond to 1, make entries in the pull-down network for them. Okay, for all the other entries which are 0, I need to make entries in the pull-up. But because of this complementary nature, I know that I can also just take whatever I have in the pull-down and complement it to get the pull-up. Okay, what do I mean by complement? Whatever was in parallel in the pull-down becomes series in the pull-up. Whatever was series in the pull-down becomes parallel in the pull-up. Okay, that is sufficient to take care of what I need. Okay, so that is the principle behind static CMOS. Okay, the advantage is at any given point in time, the output is statically pulled up to VDD or down to ground. There is no static current from VDD to ground. There will be leakage, subthreshold leakage, of course, but compared to the normal on currents, that will be very small. Okay, so effectively close to zero static power dissipation. At least that used to be the idea behind it. Nowadays, leakage is sufficiently high that the static leakage itself can be significant compared to the overall power dissipated in the circuit. Okay? Now, what's the problem with this kind of CMOS? What's the biggest problem that you can see? Can you see any problems at all? Size of what? Size, yes. I mean, so as you pointed out, I need to choose the sizes of transistors. But see, as far as functionality is concerned, I could in principle make everything minimum size and it would work. Right? It would still at least work as the right kind of gate. The delays are why I chose the sizes. Right? Functionality is not the problem. In order to get certain match, the delays between rising and falling, I chose certain sizes. Okay? But you have hit on the right idea. What did I have to do as far as the sizes were concerned? What was the main consideration that I needed to keep in mind? PMOS versus NMOS. I wanted to make them equal. So what happens? The PMOS has to be made larger, right? In general, for a given sort of current capability, the PMOS, because it has a lower mobility, I needed to make it larger. Okay? So in general, my pull-up network is going to be larger than my pull-down network. Not always the case. I mean, an example, you know, of course, the NOR gate, for example, would be a counter to that, right? I can actually, well, not NOR gate, the NAND gate, for example, would be a counter to that. I can probably get by even with smaller PMOS than NMOS under certain situations, right? But in general, for a given current delivering capability, the PMOS has to be a bit larger. That's number one problem. The second is, for every input, I need to connect it both to an NMOS and a PMOS. So the number of transistors, if I have n inputs, is 2n. Okay. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? I mean, it doesn't seem like a good thing, but is it a bad thing? That we can say only if we know that there is an alternative. Okay. So the question is, can I look for alternatives? Can I look for other ways to realize this functionality without incurring the full cost of a pull-up network and a pull-down network? Okay. How would you do it? Wait, what is that? So what you would have in that case is, you would effectively, so the suggestion is, you would have only a pull-down network. Connected to Y. And wait, so what you are saying is, you would, does this work? So what are you doing here? You have complemented it, but on the other hand, you are now trying to take two outputs and sort of wire them together. Right? So effectively at this point, this Y is going to be How is it getting pulled up in this case? It's getting pulled up through the, you still need an inverter with the PMOS, okay? So that's good. We have like one PMOS which is taking care of the complete inversion. And yeah, I'm not sure this may even actually work, right? I don't know. Effectively what it's saying over here in other words is, well, no, see, so here's the problem. So what's the problem with this approach? What happens when the pull-down network is off? So yeah, this won't work. Sorry, let me correct that. This won't work. What is the problem? It's a good idea, but what's the problem? That is less of an issue. The inverter and other thing trying to drive in opposite directions does not actually happen. What happens when the pull-down network is off? What is the input to the inverter? It's floating. It is not ground. Okay. So that's the catch over here. When the pull-down network is off, the input to the inverter is not zero. It is floating. So I do not know what the output of the inverter is going to be. Okay. That was the point of this pull-up and pull-down network. They were complementary, but it was not that when this is off, it is actually pulling to ground. No, it just means it is off, it is disconnected. Okay? So I can't take it and invert it. I can't, if I feed a floating input to an inverter, what does a floating input essentially mean? It means that I'm not specifying whether it is 0 or VDD or something in between. Depending on, you know, for all you know, some capacitive coupling from some other place, the voltage there can randomly vary. And if it does, what will happen? I will go to whichever point on the voltage transfer characteristic is defined by that. After all, my inverter has a complete voltage transfer characteristic. Right? Depending on what inputs I give over there, the output will vary. Okay. So in this case, the problem is the PDN is left floating. Right? The input to the inverter is floating. The output is undefined. It is not, in other words, going to be equal to 1. So this was the point. The pull up and pull down were doing complementary things. Not only is it that only one of them was on at a time, when the other one is off, it is not pulling down to ground, it is just disconnected. Okay? Which is why the second condition that I said, that any given point in time, one of them has to be on. If both are off, why gets disconnected from both rails? It's connected to neither VDD nor to ground. Which is bad news. Okay, so I cannot leave an output floating. Okay, so if this doesn't work, in other words, right? What else can I do? Are there any similar ideas that I can do? The core idea is right. Right? What is the core idea? I want to use only one of the networks, pull up or pull down. What do I do with the other one? What I can do is have something which says if I'm not pulling down, this should automatically pull up. Okay? So most of you might have at some point looked in digital lab or some other place like that, either using TTL gates or any other kind of gates that you have played around with, you might have come across this concept of a pull up. Right? What does a pull up resistor do? It essentially says I will always try to pull this voltage up to VDD. Okay, so let's see what would happen in that case. I will take a pull down network, connect it to the output, but then just put a resistor over here. What is the value of that resistor? I don't know, I will have to decide. Okay, how does this work? First thing, if PDN is off, that's the simple situation. What will happen to Y? VDD. Right? Y goes straight to VDD. Why is that? Because as long as Y is below VDD, some current will flow through the resistor. It will keep on delivering current over there until that voltage gets pulled all the way up to VDD, at which point the current will stop. Right? So it will go all the way up to VDD itself, not VDD minus something. Right? What happens when the PDN is on? Now things get interesting. There is a pull down network which is trying to pull Y down to 0. There is a resistor which is trying to pull Y up to VDD. How will I decide where it goes? It's going to be determined by the relative conducting capabilities or the effective resistance of the PDN. Okay. If I say that, you know, let's say that equivalent resistance is equal to, let's say, Rn, right? And this other R, I will just call it, let's say, Rp, right? Pull up. Rp mass, but pull up. Okay. What will the final voltage be? It's going to be given by Rn by Rn plus Rp into VDD. Okay. What do I want the voltage at Y to be? Ideally, I want it to be 0. Okay. Can I choose Rn to be 0? No. Right. It is after all going to be some transistors that are on. So Rn can never be 0. But I can make it much less than Rp. Or I can choose Rp to be much greater than Rn. And by doing so, my effective voltage can be made as close as I want to ground. Okay? So by choosing Rp, in other words, I can now make my output voltage as low as I want. Okay? So in other words, once again, this will behave like a gate. Let's consider the trivial case of this. The inverter. Okay? How would I go about choosing the value of R? Right? What I will essentially need over here is, in the on condition, that is when the output VO is supposed to be low, right? I will have some current flowing through this. That same current is going to flow through the NMOS. Okay? Based on that, I can calculate what VO is going to be. Let's say that VI is equal to VVD. Right? I have applied a high input voltage. What is the current through the NMOS going to be? First of all, which region of operation is it going to be in? Think about it carefully. Which region of operation is this going to be in? I have applied a high input voltage. So, channel is almost certainly present. What is VDS? What is the radius of the NMOS? It's just VO. Right? What is the VDS? Drain to source voltage. It is VO. What do I want VO to be? Small. Okay? Which region of operation is it going to be? Linear. Okay? So if I design it properly, this should be in the linear region of operation. VO should be small. Okay? So now what we can do is plug in the equation for the linear region of operation, calculate what R should be. Okay? We'll continue this in tomorrow's class and just look at what are the advantages and disadvantages of this, and similarly what are some other methods by which we can construct similar kinds of gates.